Amen. Okay, go ahead and open your Bibles over to 1 Corinthians 15. And you might see I got a title here. Brother Rob's got the title on YouTube. You might be wondering why I wrote it out like this. Well, on Wednesday, some of you were here, Pastor taught on the Great Reset. And it was an amazing teaching. If you haven't seen it, you should definitely go check it out. Apparently, there were some issues that came from it, which, I mean, we totally expect, right? Anytime you're trying to expose what the devil's doing. So, but what was interesting is I was sitting with Brother Rob, and I think we forgot to change the title. So it said, like, Philippians verse by verse, which we did for discipleship. And I don't know the exact number, but it was maybe 200 people tuning in, which, praise the Lord, right? That's a lot of people. But as soon as I think Max or someone let us know we forgot to change the title, Brother Rob changed it to The Great Reset. And we had the highest number of viewers we've ever had on a video, like over 800 or something like that. And so The Great Reset, if you don't know what that is, it's because you're not huge into conspiracy evil stuff online. Amen. So praise the Lord, you know, we should be wise concerning that which is good, simple concerning that which is evil. Amen. That's not to say it's not valuable information that we should know. And it definitely was, but the key is you gotta, as it ties into the Bible, how it relates to Scripture and end times. So, I don't know, I just kind of want to mess with the algorithm or viewers, get them to tune in just for a second, just so Brother Rob could show me the numbers plummet as we talk about what's really important. And that is, you might have guessed it already, we're going to talk today not about the Great Reset, but we're going to talk about the greatest thing that's ever happened on this planet. We're going to talk about the great resurrection. Amen? So 1 Corinthians chapter 15, hopefully you know how great the resurrection is in your life if you're a saved Christian. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I still got to make my way over there. And then after that, I'm going to have you hold like four different places today because we're going to be kind of going through the Gospels. But if you don't know, I mean you should if you've been saved for any amount of time, but 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is where you find how you get saved in this dispensation. It's the gospel. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the Bible says, verse 1, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I received, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, one, and that he was buried, two, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." So without the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, this would just be a biography, this Bible in front of you here. There would be nothing special about this guy, Jesus Christ. But there is something very special about him, and today we're going to look a little bit at that. I don't know if it was Shakespeare, but someone said, like, the world is a stage and we its players. So I want to try to set the stage today for the greatest news that this world ever heard, the greatest day that ever happened on this planet, and it's this day, the day of the resurrection. So with that, I can't draw like Pastor, so you'll have to forgive me. But I can print. I know how to print. Yeah, I can print. I can barely cut, but I can print. You like that? So yeah, we're going to be talking about that today. So, okay, you could use your fingers. You could use, if you got the little ribbons in your Bible, but you're going to want to have like four different places in your Bible today. And one of them is going to be Matthew 28. So I'll let you make your way over there. Matthew 28. And once you got Matthew 28, you're going to want to get Mark 16. Matthew 28 and Mark 16. Matthew 28, Mark 16. We are going to be flipping, so hopefully you're prepared. And once you got Mark 16, you're going to want to get Luke 24. Luke 24. Praise the Lord, we got so many accounts of this one event happening, amen? Amen, and I'm not having you do this for no reason. You know, I want you to see all the different eyewitness accounts that were reduced to writing. This is very important if you're going to prove something that it happened. So lastly, after you have, so you should have Matthew 28, Mark 16, Luke 24, And John 20 is the last one you need to have. If you got a pen, you could put it there. Like, I only have two ribbons, so I got two pens I'm also using. Okay, so hopefully you have those. And I just want to read a little something here. And I know I had you turn away from 1 Corinthians 15, so don't worry about this part. But I just want to add this. 1 Corinthians 15, I just showed you verses 1 through 4, right? How you get saved, death, burial, and resurrection. And just to kind of prove it from Scripture, because who cares what I think. 1 Corinthians 15, it also tells us what happens if there's no resurrection. Verse 12, and labor... am I in the right place? No, I'm not. Here we go. I should probably get over here. 1 Corinthians 15... Sorry, I got like my little notebook here I'm trying to flip to in the Bible everywhere. Okay, 1 Corinthians 15:12 says, "Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead?" You know, the Sadducees, they didn't believe in any kind of resurrection. Christ deniers all over the world don't believe in any kind of resurrection. But our Bible, it lays it out. It lays all the cards out on the table. But if, in verse 13, "But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen?" That's pretty plain, right? Pretty logical. If it didn't happen, it's a lie. "And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins." So it's pretty plain, brethren. This resurrection, our faith, our saving faith, the reason we're going to heaven when we die, the reason we're not staying dead, but we get to resurrect just like Jesus did, is because he did it first. He showed us the way. And there's proof of it. So I'm going to try to set the stage today. This might be, you know, review for some of you might be something simple, but I still desire the sincere milk of the word, amen. I don't know about you, but I love it. And who knows, maybe you'll learn something new today as well. So let's go ahead and we'll get going here. And I want to look at some of the characters of the resurrection before we get into the events themselves. And I don't think we'll get too far into the actual events, but like I said, I want to set the stage. I want to set up some of the characters that are involved here, because these are eyewitnesses. These are real historical people. And I want to read you something quick here. Dr. Simon Greenleaf was one of the chief figures in the early days of Harvard Law School, a legal scholar, and also served as a royal professor at Harvard Law School. In addition, Greenleaf was the author of the classic three-volume text, A Treatise on the Law of Evidence, 1842. And according to Dr. Wilbur Smith, this work, quote, "is still considered the greatest single authority on evidence in the entire literature on legal procedure." So you think this guy knew something about evidence? Mm-hmm. And he was an unbeliever, as a matter of fact. He is often cited in the field of Christian legal apologetics. In his essay, The Testimony of the Evangelist, Examined by the Rules of Evidence Administered in Courts of Justice, Greenleaf wrote the following: "All that Christianity asks of men is that they would be consistent with themselves, that they would treat its evidences as they treat the evidence of other things, and that they would try and judge its actors and witnesses as they deal with their fellow men when testifying to human affairs and actions in human tribunals." So you trust an eyewitness in the court of law, you know, be consistent and have the same kind of grace and trust to these people that were eyewitnesses of Christ's resurrection. He says here, "Let the witnesses to the resurrection be compared with themselves, with each other, and with surrounding facts and circumstances, and let their testimony be sifted as if it were given in a court of justice on the side of the adverse party, the witness being subjected to a rigorous cross-examination. The result, it is confidently believed, will be an undoubted conviction of their integrity, ability, and truth." So this is the guy that basically he wrote stuff on the laws of evidence that they still use in courts today, and he put Jesus to the test. He put the resurrection to the test based on his stringent criteria for evidence, and he came out on the other side as a born-again Christian. So if you're watching this today and maybe you're a skeptic, you don't believe this stuff, I pray that this will help your faith. This will build your faith. Okay, so now, as far as some of these characters that are associated with the resurrection, and I guess you could also title this, Women's Appreciation Day or something, because we're going to find there's a lot of women that are involved in this thing. The first of which, I don't know if you can see this, but the first of which is Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene. She was the first person that the Lord Jesus Christ appeared to, as a matter of fact. So spiritually speaking, you know, ladies, you know, I know how it is. Sometimes you think you're like a second-class citizen, or you can't do anything for God, or maybe all you could do is have children and be a mom. Well, Mary wasn't. And she was like the closest one to Jesus. Not in some weird Catholic Da Vinci Code way, in a real truthful biblical way. Amen, so you got Mary Magdalene. Let's look at Mark 16:9. And not only was she just a just a woman, no kids or anything like that, but look in Mark 16:9. The Bible says, "Now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils." So, I mean, you could even be some devil-possessed woman, and you have a run-in with Jesus Christ, it'll change your life. Amen. And you could end up doing great things for the Lord Jesus Christ. So, ladies, I mean, you could do something for God, amen. It doesn't matter where you come from. The Lord can use you, amen. He can use you in a mighty, mighty way. All right, so, Mark 16:9, and look in Mark 16, look at the next verse in Mark 16. Look at verse 10. Not only was she filled with devils, verse 10, and she went and told them that had been with him as they mourned and wept, and they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. So she had this wonderful experience. She saw the risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and went and told everyone, and they didn't believe her. Man, that's rough. But one thing you got to understand is that historically speaking, a woman's testimony was worth half that of a man's. So I don't know if you get into the two or three witnesses, if that involves, you know, if you got women coming to tell you what happened, but you ladies know better than men do. You know how you can stretch the truth, let's say. But a woman's testimony worth half that of a man. So here's a question for the skeptic. You know, they'll say the Bible was just written by man, right? Well, if the Bible was just written by man, one, why would these men write down in their document, why would they give credit to a woman for being the first one to see Jesus Christ? Wouldn't that be kind of shameful? That'd be kind of weird. Why would they give her the credit? Not only they gave her the credit for being the first to see him, they make themselves look bad here. They didn't believe her. They called her, they thought she was a liar. They thought she was hallucinating, right? So, ladies, look at that. I mean, you can be way closer to the Lord than men can. And we're going to see more about that. So Mary Magdalene there, you know, she was denied and they didn't believe her. And man's humiliating lack of belief is shown in that book, because that book shows all the ugly truths about us. And, you know, they didn't ascribe to the hashtag believe her movement or the Me Too movement back then. They didn't treat women very well, but Jesus Christ always treated women well. Jesus Christ and the Bible. I got a note here from Dr. Ruckman. I'll read in a sec, but you'll see. Don't let the world fool you. Don't let them think that the Bible is just written to oppress women and keep them down, and really they need to join the feminist movement, or they need to have all these rights. And that's why you have miserable women who don't even know what they are these days. Amen. Okay, so we have Mary Magdalene. Then look in Luke 24. Luke 24. So Mary Magdalene, she was in on it. And in Luke 24, verse 1, Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. So there's others. There's other women that are with them. It's not just Mary Magdalene alone. Look at verse 10. It was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and other women that were with them, which told these things unto the apostles. Verse 11, and their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed them not. So it wasn't just Mary. They didn't believe any of the women. So, these characters are cool that I printed out, but there's only like three of them. So Mary Magdalene, and then who else did it say there? Joanna. So I'll just, here's Joanna. You did it. Oh, amen, sister. All right, so you got Joanna. And who else does it say here? We'll learn more about Mary, the mother of James, in a minute. But you have Joanna. Now, let's see here. Who is Joanna? Let's go to Luke chapter 8. Who's this Joanna? I just think it's so cool that the Bible gives these women credit. Amen? I mean, they're named. They're written down in an eternal document. That's better than you and I got. Luke chapter 8, and look at we'll start from verse 1. Luke chapter 8, and it came to pass afterward that he went throughout every city and village, preaching and showing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God, and the 12 were with him. And certain women, which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary called Magdalene, out of whom went seven devils, and Joanna, the wife of Chuzza, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others which ministered unto him of their substance. So Joanna was the wife of Chuzza, Herod's steward. So I'm sure she was a vital piece in this whole thing too. Maybe she brought some great information like, hey, Jesus, here's what's going on over at Herod's right now. They're coming after you. Don't go here. But what I find really interesting is that it says in verse 2, certain women which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities. So we know that Mary Magdalene is one of them. But it almost seems like it says, and Joanna, and Susanna, and many others. So it almost seems like we got like a coven of former, devil-possessed witches or something going on here, man. So we got Joanna. We got Susanna. Isn't the Lord funny who he decides to use for his glory?
Yeah.
Amen? So Joanna, Susanna. And so these are all the women that were headed to the tomb that morning. So I'm just trying to paint a picture for you here. It wasn't just Mary Magdalene or, a couple of them. It was like a group of women. And, so we have Joanna there, and then Susanna, and it says these were the same women. So look at Luke 23. So yeah, I mean, these women, they were there that morning, but where were they before that? Where were they before that? Luke chapter 23, look at verse 27. And there followed him a great company of people and of women, which also bewailed and lamented him. Look at verse 49. And all his acquaintance and the women that followed him from Galilee stood afar off, beholding these things. Look at verse 55. And the women also, which came with him from Galilee, followed after and beheld the sepulchre and how his body was laid. And they returned and prepared spices and ointments and rested the Sabbath day according to the commandment. So we got some ride or dies here. We got some women that they didn't just show up that day, but they were with Jesus throughout his entire ministry. They were there at his death, at the crucifixion. They were there at his burial, and they showed up at his resurrection. Where were his disciples? You find you a good woman, she'll follow you to the end, man. It doesn't matter. She'll follow you all the way. And the Lord had a group of good women with him. We're going to find out more about these women, but I'll tell you, part of the evidence of Laodicea, in my opinion, is seeing how much women and children are in control of men. And so I think that that's one of the big signs of apostasy. We don't have men that are following Jesus Christ all the way, picking up their cross and following him all out 100%. We got women doing it for us. We got Deborahs. But you know, I'm not going to go unless you go, honey. You got to watch out for that, man. All right, so turn over to Matthew 27 now. Matthew 27. Man, what a blessing to have a good, either good mother, good wife, even just a single woman faithful to the things of God. You could do mighty things. Matthew 27, and look at verse 55. And many women were there beholding afar off, which followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering unto him, among which was Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's children. So, a couple things here. I want to read to you Dr. Ruckman's note. So you know it's going to be good. Dr. Ruckman's note on verse 55. He says here, few women ever opposed or hated Jesus Christ until the feminist movement of the Laodicean church period. In biblical days, women had much more spiritual discernment. Bob Jones Sr. said, listen up, the world's most moral monstrosity is a woman who doesn't love Jesus Christ. Woo! Every social, emotional, economic, or material benefit any American woman has came from Americans reading, believing, and following the King James 1611 authorized Bible. See, we're so spoiled in this country, we think it's always been like this. There's always been these freedoms afforded to us. You go over to other countries right now, ladies, and see how you like it. Yeah. And so as bad as things are now, you got to understand, this book is what elevated this country and gave us all of our freedoms, men and women alike. But I thought that was such a great note. And that quote there, the world's most moral monstrosity is a woman who doesn't love Jesus Christ. Ain't that the truth, man? Look around you today, talking about women being in charge of men, right, and running things. It's a shame, and it's opposite. You know, woe unto them that call good evil, evil good. It's opposite of God's will, amen? But praise the Lord, he had some good women following him there. Okay, now let's look at the next character here, and we're going to kind of park it here because this is super interesting. But we have... It says in verse 56, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph. Mary, the mother of James and Joseph. Okay, so who is this Mary? In Matthew 28:1, she's called the other Mary. You see that? Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to the sepulcher. In Mark 16:1, she's called the mother of James. And also in Luke 24:10. And in Mark 3:18, go over to Mark 3:18. So whoever she is, she's the mother of James. Mark 3:18. Now, who is this James? Which James? Mark 3:18. The Bible says, and Andrew and Philip and Bartholomew and Matthew and Thomas and James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus and Simon the Canaanite. All right, so we got a James there who's the son of Alphaeus. In Mark 15:40, she's called the mother of James the Less and of Joseph. So you know you got James and John, right? Sons of Thunder, those brothers. But then you got James the Less. You know, some people think maybe it's because he was shorter, or maybe because he's just lesser level of apostle, but you got James the Less. And so, go over to John 19, 25. Let's look at John 19, verse 25. So, Mary, mother of James, and that James is the son of Alphaeus. Did you follow that? So, we have both of his parents. Now, let's see a little bit more here. John 19:25. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother, so there's one Mary, and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. So we got three Marys. Jesus' mother Mary, Mary Magdalene, and this says Mary the wife of Cleopas. So if you run the cross references, this Mary, she is the mother of James and Joseph, James being the son of Alphaeus, and she's also called the wife of Cleopas here. Well, what you're going to find is, and I think that might sag a little bit, what you're going to find is that Cleopas is the Hebrew form of the name Alphaeus. So they're one and the same. So she's Cleopas' wife. She's the mother of James the Less, and she's the wife of Cleopas, or Alphaeus. Hopefully that all connects for you. I know when you get into names, my mother's brother's boyfriend's cousin said, you know, it's always hard when you're telling stories, but I think that's pretty clear. Hopefully this is getting more, what I'm trying to get across to you is this thing is like personal. Yeah. This is intimate right here. These aren't just people. This is Jesus' aunt. It said the sister of Mary, right? So then if she's a sister of Mary and her son is James the Less, what does that mean? Who is James the Less to Jesus? That's his cousin. So when he says, my brethren, he's not just talking about Jews. This thing is like, you talk about like some crazy soap opera stuff here. This is, where do you think they get all the themes from? This is like way crazier than Days of Our Lives and all that. This is some beautiful stuff right here. Okay, so that's Mary, Cleopas there. And now, if you thought that was enough, I won't go into some of the other possible sons of her possible sons. For now, I'll leave that for another time. But she was there. She went to the tomb there. And lastly, go back over to Mark 16. Let's look at Mark 16:1. Mark 16:1. And it's so beautiful when you look at all the Gospels. The Lord, the Lord will get you. This thing is set up in a way where if you come to it with an unbelieving heart, you're going to find contradictions. Yeah. You're like, well, it says this here, but then it says that there. Like Dr. Simon Greenleaf said, if you come with just an honest heart, you're going to see, and I thought I heard like with police officers and stuff, they say it's actually sketchier if all the witnesses have the exact same testimony, because it shows they all got together and agreed on, okay, we're going to say this and then this and then this. But when you have a little bit of variation between the different ones, but it all kind of harmonizes, that's like when you get into some really strong evidence. So, all right, let's look at the next woman here. Mark 16, chapter 1. And when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James, that's Cleopas, and Salome had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. So Salome, let's see, who is this Salome? It also shows that a beautiful name back in the day can maybe not be so beautiful nowadays. I go to Kirsten, I'm like, you know, that's a beautiful name, Salome. She's like, salami? Yeah. I was like, okay. Maybe that's why she was so spiritual. She got made fun of her whole life because she's Salome. All right. Oh, I don't want to show you that yet because I want to show you this. So Salome, who is Salome? Let's find out who Salome is. Go back to Matthew 27. Matthew 27. And look at verse 56. Matthew 27, verse 56. Among which was Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Joseph and the mother of Zebedee's children. So who are Zebedee's children? James and John, right? James and John Zebedee, his inner circle, along with Peter, the brothers, Boanerges, the sons of thunder. They're the Zebedee boys. So their mom The one that, remember, she came desiring a thing of Jesus and asked, you know, they want to, you know, can they sit on your right and your left? This woman right here, Salome. That's her. So, okay, we went through Mary Magdalene, right? You don't have to be anything. You could just be full of devils, you know, but then you get saved, you follow Jesus, and you could be the closest one to Jesus. But that's not to say that it's not important to be a godly mother. Look at this. Mary Cleopas had some sons that were disciples that followed Jesus. Salome, James, and John. And it wasn't enough that it was just their sons. It would have been one thing if they're just good mothers, you know, they raise their sons and they followed the Lord. No, they followed the Lord better than their sons. They were at the tomb first thing in the morning when it was still dark, getting, you know, bright and sunny. I don't know how, you know, even James and John, they weren't there at that time. Maybe they're still sleeping. I don't know. But their moms got up before them and went to go anoint the body. Wow. So, ladies, I'll give it to you this way. Don't think that just because you're a mom, all I am is a mom. That's all I do. I don't do anything for the Lord. I don't go win souls. I don't knock on doors, pass tracts. I'm just a mom. Hello?
Yeah. That's good preaching, brother.
Yeah. We need some moms, man. Yeah. And praise the Lord, you know, my mom was not like these women. But, I mean, Romans 8:28, the Lord can use anything. A lot of the things I learned in my life, what not to do, I learned from my mom. So the Lord will bless it either way, amen?
Yeah.
But, I mean, this is cool stuff, is it not? Look at this. Yeah. The first people to come to the tomb were some moms. I was watching this thing when it had to do with, like, all the election fraud and stuff. Supposed, they were saying it, not me, right? They were saying it. And this guy, he's like a physicist who did all these numbers. He's really smart. He said that he was going state to state, and the moms from, like, all these school boards and stuff, the moms were the ones coming to him, figuring out the numbers, saying, we're going to go to the district. We're going to do this. We're going to submit these papers. We're going to do that. And he's like, man, he's like, if it wasn't for the moms, this thing wouldn't be gaining any traction. There's something about you get a mom mad when it comes to her kids. They, to the bitter end, man, they will destroy you. So we need some of that, amen? We need some of that. So it's on, yeah. So we had Salome was there too. Wow, that's awesome. So some commentators think there are, you know, as many as like a dozen women that came that morning. So, I mean, I could just put a bunch of stick figures and say other women, but just there's other women too. So a bunch of women are coming to see Jesus. Men, where you at? Man, I hope we'd have some men coming to see Jesus when, the, you know, this rapture is getting ready to happen. I want to find Jesus. I don't want some woman to tell me about it. And praise God, you know, if she does, I hope I believe her. Okay, so now let's kind of break down the timeline of this all happening. So now that we have the stage, we got some of the players. Let's look at the time frame here, and it can get pretty doctrinal. But Luke 24, I mean, this is pretty simple. But just look at Luke 24. We don't have to turn to all of them. You know, Luke 24:1. Now, upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, came they unto the sepulcher. So, the first day of the week. That is very important because Seventh-day Adventists teach that Sunday worship was created by Constantine for the Roman Catholic Church. And they actually attribute part of the mark of the beast. They think going to church on Sunday has to do with the mark of the beast, Seventh-day Adventists. But the Bible shows the truth. Amen. The Bible shows that they got ready to go see Jesus on the first day of the week. Go over to Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20. It's not enough that I tell you or that I even, you know, quote the scripture, because most people don't look it up anyways. I want you to see it with your own two eyes. Acts chapter 20, verse 7. And upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart on the morrow, and continued to speak until midnight. So we see that the early churches met on the first day of the week. For time's sake, you don't have to turn there, but 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 1 and 2, they took up collection on the first day of the week. I do want you to see this one. Acts chapter 2, go over to Acts chapter 2. The Holy Spirit came down on the first day of the week. How about that for a reason to go to church on Sundays? Acts chapter 2, verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. The day of Pentecost was fully come. All right, let's cross-reference that with Leviticus 23. Go to Leviticus 23. Give you a good old-fashioned Bible study. Leviticus 23. It seems simple, and in your mind you're like, well, yeah, of course, makes sense. But you need to know this in case you come across one of these people. You never know when it's going to happen. And I found in my life that oftentimes it won't just be one person, it'll be another person. And it's not so much important that you tell the person challenging you, it's the objective third party that's going to look to you and be like, huh, what do you have to say about that? You got to be ready always to give an answer for the hope that lieth within you. All right, so Leviticus 23, this is pretty clear as well. Leviticus 23, where am I? Verse 15. And ye shall count unto you from the morrow after the Sabbath. From the day that ye brought the sheaf of the wave offering, seven Sabbaths shall be complete. Even unto the morrow after the seventh Sabbath shall ye number 50 days. That's talking about Pentecost. And ye shall offer a new meat offering unto the Lord. So is that clear enough? Is that a good enough reason for coming to church on Sundays, the first day of the week and not Saturday? We're not Jews. We don't do the Sabbath. Okay, so we got it was on a Sunday. Amen? Yeah. All right, go back over to Luke 24, 1. Luke 24, 1. Luke 24, 1. Now, upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning. All right, Matthew 28. If you don't have all the places, don't worry about it. Don't get frustrated trying to get there. I'll just read them. Matthew 28, 1. In the end of the Sabbath, is that clear enough? Sabbath is over. It's the next day. As it began to dawn toward the first day of the week. So it's very early. It was as it began to dawn. Mark 16, 2. Here's one of those places, right? Like if you're a skeptic looking to be convinced, you're going to be like, well, that's not the same, right? You got to harmonize this thing here. Mark 16, verse 2, it says, and very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre when? At the rising of the sun. Okay, man, so like the time frame is shrinking in here. It's getting tighter and tighter. We're zoning in on it here. So we have very early in the morning, as it began to dawn, at the rising of the sun, and you don't have to turn there, but John 20, verse 1 says, when it was yet dark. So we got like anywhere from like 5 a.m. to 6:30 is around the time that they're coming here and they're arriving at the tomb. I can't even bring myself to preach on us we should show up earlier to church, amen? They're way more spiritual than us, amen? Oh, man, yeah, I'm just going to skip that whole point. Let's move on. Okay, so we got the women, we got the time, and now let's look a little at the tomb, okay? Let's look at the tomb. Okay, so Mark 16:3. Make your way over to Mark 16:3. Let's see about this tomb here. And I'm going to do this for a second. Mark 16:3. All right, so it says here, and they said among themselves, who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? So they left. Remember, this thing has been sealed. there's a bunch of Roman soldiers protecting this thing, making sure it's not gonna, no one's gonna get in. So these women, I don't know if it's like, you know, maybe they're being, I don't think so, but you could say maybe they're just being airheads, you know, they just take off to go do it and they don't, oh wait, there's a thing blocking the door, how are we gonna get in? Or you could look at it like they're just faithful, right? But it seems like they just go to see Jesus. They don't know how they're gonna do it. They don't know what's gonna happen. But as they're on their way, they're like, who's gonna roll it away for us? Because it was a great stone, amen? So, I mean, and if you got like a bunch of women, like 12 women can't roll away this stone, that's like seems pretty heavy. So they're wondering, who's gonna roll away the stone? Verse 4, and when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. So it was very great, and it was rolled away. Now, let's see about it being rolled away. Matthew 28. Go to Matthew 28. And we're going to look at verse 2. Matthew 28, look at verse 2. And it says here in verse 2, and behold, there was a great earthquake. For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. Okay. And I want a verse. Where's that other verse? Well, I'm sure we'll find it at some point. But angel of the great earthquake, angel of the Lord comes, rolls away the stone. It says somewhere that the keepers, I think maybe it says that later in Matthew 28. It says, Matthew 28, verse 3, his countenance was like lightning and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. So earthquake happens, stone rolls away, angel of the Lord comes, sits on this guy. Hey, buddy, this guy passes out. He's really excited about the Lord resurrecting. So this guy, you know, they fall down as dead men, which is usually how men or women respond to seeing angels. They're scared. They're frightened. Satan is transformed into an angel of light. So anytime you have some experience, some warm, fuzzy experience where you just feel like syrup's being poured on you and you see an angel, woo, you better like Martin Luther, throw an inkwell at it. You better say, you're not Jesus Christ. Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. You're Satan. So he comes down, and by the way, I don't think you guys are dumb by me doing this. I had to do this to understand the timeline. I was getting confused, like going through all the different things. So for me, it helps. So he comes, that guy, you know, passes out or whatever. He comes, sits on the stone there. All right, so that happens. Oh, here's a very important note as well. Go over to Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4. I'll start to bring it home here. Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4. And I mean, you should be scared of an angel. In the Old Testament, one angel killed 186,000 men. So, and Jesus said, what did he say? Like, you know, I could call down 12 legions of angels right now if I wanted. So he's got backup, man. You better watch out. So Ephesians chapter 4, did I say 4?
Yeah,
4. Yeah, Ephesians 4. Ephesians chapter 4. It's very important to note here that the stone was not rolled away so that Jesus could come out. It was rolled away so that the disciples could go in. That's very important. We don't have time to get into it, but you get into the nature of the glorified, resurrected body and its powers. You know, Jesus passes through a door later on. Like, some stone wasn't going to keep him in there. And spiritually speaking, praise the Lord. The Lord's going to make it to where you can get to him. He can get to you any way he wants, but he's going to make it to where he's available for you. So Ephesians chapter 4, verse 9. It says here, now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? So Jesus had already
resurrected. If you look at, Dr. Erkman's got great notes on it, but toward the end of the Sabbath, which would be six, that's when Jesus got up. He already had gone down into the heart of the earth, dropped off our sins, and now was coming back up, and that's when he appears to Mary. So we'll see how much more we can get in here. But they call it the greatest story ever told for a reason. I mean, this is incredible stuff going on here, and we haven't even gotten to him showing up yet, amen? This is just like the opening credits. So, okay, John chapter 20, verse 1. Go back to John chapter 20, verse 1. And this is where you get into the part where you need this kind of stuff, because it'll get really confusing if you don't map it all out. So I'll give you this and we'll leave it. John chapter 20, verse 1. And notice how John, which we know is the book that, you know, it was specifically written for people to believe. John wrote his gospel after the others. He was already familiar with a lot of the same doctrines of, you know, being saved by faith and whatnot. So it's very interesting to see who John pays the most attention to versus the other gospels. So it says, the first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early when it was yet dark. It doesn't mention the other women. Unto the sepulcher, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulcher. Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and saith unto them, they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulcher, and we know not where they have laid him. So this is very important, and it's very interesting. So the women show up at the tomb here. They don't see this guy yet, so I'll take him away. He came, sat upon the stone, but then he was gone. They come. All Mary sees, empty tomb. She doesn't see an angel at that point. She doesn't go in. She shows up, sees it's gone, empty tomb. They've taken the soldiers aren't there. And they're like, they've taken the body. They took his body away. She jets. She immediately runs off. So, I mean, you know, praise the Lord, she was like ready to go, right? But if she would have hung around a little longer, she would have gotten some more information. So she takes off to go tell Peter and John. But the ladies, they continue to make their way to the tomb there. And go over to Matthew 28, back over to Matthew 28. You noticed, hopefully you noticed that, how in John chapter 20, what does she tell Peter and John? They have taken away the Lord out of the sepulcher, and we know not where they have laid him. So that's all that she knew at that time. So Matthew 28, and look at verse 5. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay. And in Mark 16:5, in verse 4, you see that they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. But it doesn't say they saw the, you know, angel of the Lord sitting on the stone. It says in verse 5, and entering into the sepulcher, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. So they go in, and this guy's inside there. And they were affrighted. So Mary, she already took off. They went in. They see this guy. And so they enter. The angel of the Lord who rolled away the stone appears to them, and he tells them to go tell the disciples what? Matthew 28, verse 7. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him, lo, I have told you. So he tells them, go tell the disciples that Jesus is risen. So he wasn't taken. He told them he's risen. Go tell the disciples he's risen. Okay, so John chapter 20, we're going to close it right here. John chapter 20, verses 3 and 4. So this is after Mary runs, goes and gets Peter and John. You know, she knows to go to the inside circle right away, right? See that? And she says, they've taken him away. We don't know where he is. Verse 3, Peter therefore went forth and that other disciple and came to the sepulcher. So they ran both together, and the other disciple did outrun Peter and came first to the sepulcher. Hopefully you know that that's John. He doesn't speak of himself. He doesn't name himself when he's taught. He said that, you know, the disciple whom Jesus loved or the beloved, but he doesn't give himself credit, like name credit like that. So that's Peter and John. So as the women take off and they're afraid, right? And it says in another place that they didn't say anything to any man, for they were affrighted. So I don't know, but in my mind's eye, I'm picturing Peter and John, they roll up, they sprint, right? So Mary's like back there. She told them they take off. She's probably trying her best, but they come up. John beats Peter because he's younger, but he stops. And there's a saying like fools rush in where angels trot or something like that. Yeah, dare to trot. So he stops, but Peter runs all the way in. And as they're approaching, it would seem, there we go, we're going to end it right here. As they're approaching, the other women are taking off. They have just seen the angel. They're super scared. They take off. The Bible says they didn't say anything to any man. So they come in. Peter goes in. And he doesn't see, if you look in verse 10, John 20, verse 10. I'll just finish out this passage and we'll close it. Verse 6, then cometh Simon Peter following him and went into the sepulchre and seeth the linen clothes lie, and the napkin that was about his head not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Then went in also that other disciple, which came first to the sepulchre, and he saw and believed. For as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away again unto their own home. So it would appear that in another verse it says that Peter departed wondering in himself what this all meant. So Peter went, he saw that he's not there, and he takes off. He's just like in a confused state wondering what's going on. But you saw in John right there, it says that he saw and he believed. So at that point, John saw, and you know, something swelling up. He's like, oh, he rose from the dead. He's resurrected. He's alive, right? So, and then, yeah, we're ending it here, but then we'll see if I continue this at some other point. That part two. The whole millennium is just going to be me teaching part twos. No, I'm just kidding. Then, you know, Mary's going to come up after, and John departs, and that is when we're going to have the encounter between Mary and the Lord Jesus Christ. So we'll end it with that. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word. It is perfect. It's infallible. It's full of infallible proofs that will lead the honest soul to the truth, which is you. You are the way, the truth, and the life. And we thank you so much for the promise that we're not going to stay dead just like you didn't stay dead. We're going to raise from the dead, or we're going to be caught up together in the air. And we look forward to that day. Please bless the rest of this day in the preaching. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay.